the architecture of a reusable rocket is very similar to a skyscraper. Starting at the bottom, you have the thrust structure, which on a skyscraper is comparable to the foundation. It handles all the primary structural loads and supports the rest of the structure. Moving up, you have the first stage, second stage, and inner stage. Those all being on a skyscraper, the large primary structural I-beams and columns that support the entire structure.
So the purpose of the stage one and stage two tanks is primarily to hold the propellants for the vehicle. So that's liquid oxygen and liquid natural gas, but they also serve as the primary airframe for the rocket. So that means they'll carry all the loads from the acceleration of the vehicle, from aerodynamic loading, and of course the pressurization of the tanks themselves.
So the team just completed a major milestone. That milestone was completing the stage one's thrust structure, primary structure build. So having that core assembly completed is really a good foundation and proves that our design, analysis, and testing schemas work for the entire rest of the vehicle.
Stage two tank has been completed and is been handed off to integration. The stage one tank weldment is currently in progress. Everything gets integrated up into these stage tanks. The tanks are the foundation for all the progress.
So in order to start sizing and designing the propellant tanks, we've got to start with the requirements. Those are going to be, you know, what volumes of propellant do the tanks need to hold? What temperature are those propellants going to be at? We also need to understand the loads that act on the vehicle. Design for manufacturability is a really big part of making the propellant tanks. As a primary structure comprising most of the rocket, really, we've got to be very careful about all the decisions we make and understand if they're hitting the right balance in terms of performance and manufacturability.
There's a lot of key considerations that goes into designing a booster thrust structure. First and foremost is the thrust of the engine. So we need to design a relatively lightweight structure to take really immense loads. We have to see upwards of 3.5 million pounds of force at liftoff. And this number grows as we ascend through the atmosphere and atmospheric pressure drops away. One of the biggest technical challenges with designing a booster with 13 engines is just the packaging. Everything is so tightly packed together, and this is somewhat intentional. The more dense they can make it, the higher performance it's going to be.
So reusability drives design and manufacturing decisions in a few ways. On the design side, rockets that are reusable need systems like landing legs and grid fins in order to land, which are not considered at all in expendable rockets. On the manufacturing side, we're always looking for ways to make rockets cheaper to produce and quicker to get to launch.
For a really high-performance booster like Terran R, we try to push the margins as tight as we can, but this means we also need to go verify that our designs are going to meet the expectations we set for them. We follow our designs and analysis up with tests, and that's part of the reason why we're doing our acceptance testing now.
Because the first articles that we're producing, both for Stage 1 and Stage 2, are flight articles, we need to rely really heavily on our analysis tools and subscale testing in order to tell us basically that the design is good, that it meets the requirements, and that it matches all the analysis and methods we do.
Once we have design criteria, one of the first selections that we take as an engineering team is what materials that we're going to make the vehicle out of.
So aluminum alloys have been widely used in other aerospace applications and other rocket programs. We mainly used these aluminum alloys here for their strength to weight ratio. They are also very performant in a wide range of temperatures, namely cryogenic temperatures.
Plus, we've also got a reusable booster on Terran R, which means that we need to survive all the entry conditions. This is really high heating events, really high atmospheric pressures. We're entering at very rapid speeds.
We want to outfit stage one with materials that can survive multiple flights. If we were to choose a material that isn't as capable, that's another design decision we'd have to make later on or repeat multiple times. So if we can make those decisions early on and establish them, that's just gonna pay off in spades later down the road.
So we start with raw material, which we machine to thickness and flatness and remove a lot of the extra mass. Then we form that to give the panels curvature, weld them side by side to create barrel sections. Then we load these sections to the circumferential friction stir welder, join them end to end to grow out the full length of the stage tank and cap off the ends with dome sections.
We use three types of friction stir welding. Conventional fixed pin friction stir welding, retractable pin tool friction stir welding, and self-reacting friction stir welding. Since we are working with such a uniquely large article, we have to make and design various custom toolings to ensure that our parts are properly constrained and able to withstand the friction stir weld process. When we're designing our own tooling to interact with our specific parts, and all this kind of accumulates into purpose-built machines just for our rocket.
Stage two uses an integrated orthogrid pattern cut into the panels. Stage one uses stringers that are friction stir welded to the skin And this is due to geometric differences and also differences in the loading conditions on the two articles.
On stage two, because the loads are lower, it doesn't need to be as stiff as stage one. And that allows us to use a thinner material stock and still achieve enough buckling margin in that stage. And that basically gets us away from having to do the additional process of welding in stringers and adding in rings. We don't do that on stage one, mostly because the loads are so much higher that it would require us to use a really large amount of material stock.
For our structural joints specifically, we use a number of NDE techniques to ensure our parts meet fit, form, and function. They are namely ultrasonic thickness testing, phased array ultrasonic testing, radiographic testing, and visual inspection.
So the way we've really made build go quickly and cut down the cycle time of the thrust structure build is really twofold. One, manufacturing's played a big role on the design side, really looking at what features can we have full-sized from our machined parts, so that when we're on the actual factory floor, all we're doing is assembling the parts. No drilling, welding, or bonding involved. So in areas where we can't do full-size features in the parts themselves, for whatever upstream reason, we invested really heavily in advanced manufacturing techniques such as advanced drilling, where it removes work imperfections from the equation.
A big challenge we've had to overcome in the tank manufacturing process is controlling tank form. It's very difficult to make a perfect cylinder. We've developed some custom tooling to address this problem at the downstream work centers, particularly at the circumferential friction stir welder. We've come up with some great tooling to fix the barrel form locally by the edges of the actual joint itself to ensure we have perfect fit up.
There's like always a parallel path approach at this design and build where in real time we're developing the process and making flight hardware. That challenge in itself, juggling various kind of unknowns and new processes and new implementations of tooling and equipment, is quite difficult.
That really means we need to be in really tight coordination with our partner teams. So as we're producing this first article, it's really critical for the design engineers and responsible engineers to be out on the floor, walking through our different workstations and understanding the processes as they're actually happening now.
So the next stage for thrust structures, we're gonna bring it inside from test and start to do all of our fluids, avionics, and propulsion integration.
So we're getting through structural acceptance testing of some of our primary structures right now. I'm really looking forward to seeing the stages become integrated, seeing it all come together. Fluids, avionics, thermal protection systems, integrating those major assemblies into completed stages and seeing those stages ship out the door to get tested at our downstream sites.
So while we're locked in on getting flight one build completed on time and successfully, we're also really looking to the future, thinking deeply about how we can improve our processes to improve scalability, knowing that this is the first of many more to come.